All right, so welcome everyone to the March Global Developers Meetup for App Inventor. We've got a relatively short agenda for today to cover. And I just wanted to start with the iOS update. So for those of you who have been on our blog, been on the community site, you have probably heard the news by now that we have officially been accepted into the App Store. The companion actually went live last Thursday at like 6:30 p.m. Eastern time. But we made the official announcement on Monday at noon. So been up in the store for a couple days now, getting pretty good traction so far. We've had over 86,000 installations in the last week. We're also seeing quite a few bug reports, so we know what we're going to be busy with the next couple days as we churn through all of those, trying to fix as many issues as possible. So we appreciate your patience as we continue to iron out some of the kinks. Continue to share your experiences. Let us know what's working, what's not working. If you can share AIA files, that's really helpful because we can test them ourselves and make sure that it works correctly, both on the Android and the iOS side of things. We've also seen a couple reports of issues with connectivity. So we imagine that's people trying to connect over cellular and not Wi-Fi. But we'll continue to monitor that situation. A future update will include support for the WebRTC connectivity, which is what Android currently does. And it's just generally more robust to different network configurations. But for the time being, iOS basically uses what in the Android world is called legacy mode until such time as we can support the WebRTC functionality. So kind of following on the heels of the iOS release, the next big thing on our plate at the moment is we've been working on the iOS build infrastructure currently to support ad hoc distribution of apps. And then with the eventual goal also to provide support for publishing to the App Store, but that's going to come at a later time. And that is currently in closed beta. We haven't yet set up a system to allow people to be invited to that. So we've been mainly doing it manually. All of the MIT staff and students have access to that system, as well as our power users. And our goal is to kind of slowly roll that out as we try to understand the requirements of what types of builds are going to be needed, what additional constraints the iOS infrastructure is going to place on how apps need to be built, and just in general, trying to understand the software and hardware requirements so that we can scale it appropriately. And some people probably don't know this, but we actually, on a typical day, have 15 build servers to support the load when it comes to building Android applications. And sometimes we have to scale that up to 18 or 21 if there are competitions going on, for example. So we're just trying to keep that in mind as we continue to build out the infrastructure. You know, hopefully we'll have an option for those of you interested in building apps, ideally by the end of the summer. But there are going to be a lot of different factors that play into that. The next item I wanted to cover is the Blockly update. So for those of you who have been around in the App Inventor world for a couple of years now, you may remember App Inventor 1 or App Inventor Classic, which had its own separate Java app that you ran to program your code, which provided the blocks editor. We then switched with AI2 to using Blockly, which is a Google library. Originally, it was written internally as the blocks editor for App Inventor, but then when App Inventor was moved from Google to MIT, the Blockly project spun off as its own independent project within Google. And now many different blocks editors that you've used online probably use Blockly now. App Inventor is just one of them. So we did our last Blockly update in 2017. which of course brought a number of useful features like zooming and things like that to the App Inventor Blocks editor. And Lee has been the team member responsible for doing this latest round of updates, which we're hoping to release over the summer as well. The goal being that it would be kind of available for the coming school year without necessarily disrupting exams and things like that towards the end of the current school year. So we're hoping to put up a test server probably early April at this point, although that's subject to change, depending on how much effort we need to put into the iOS bug fixing extravaganza. So, but expect to potentially see some requests to help us test that functionality going forward. The next thing, which I believe is a pretty big one, and it's been an issue for a while now, is an update to the Files API, both in terms of internal utilities that extension developers rely on, but also in terms of a number of components that interact with the file system. So Android 10 requires that most access to the file system is kind of off limits unless you have certain permissions. And that's going to be even more strongly enforced starting in Android 11. And so in Android 11, which we will be required to target starting in August of this year for new apps and in November of this year for existing apps, which would include the companion, those are going to need to fall under this new regime of file access. And so new apps will not be allowed to access anything outside of their app-specific data directory in the data, the typical like SD card or storage partition. So that has a lot of implications for tutorials and things like that and a number of the components that rely on that. Last summer, we did an update when we did the Android 10 target that addressed some of these issues, but probably not as satisfactorily as anyone would have wanted. So there's some continued work that is being done there, and I'm gonna be publishing a design document for some suggested changes to the file component to address these issues on Android 11. As part of this, I'm kind of also hoping to make the file component a little bit richer. You know, we've often had questions of, you know, why can I not make a directory with the file component, for example? Why can't I move a file or copy a file? So we're hoping to add a little bit more functionality there, especially because at the moment, the iOS version doesn't support any sort of extensions. So these mechanisms have typically been provided by extensions. So the fact that iOS doesn't provide that means that it's going to be severely lacking some sort of standard utilities people expect when they're working with files. So we're gonna put out an open call for comments on that to try to get a better understanding from the community of what will or will not work for them. Also from extension developers, how the internal API changes will affect them. Ideally, we'll keep everything there, but deprecate the old functions, which we did also with the Android 10 update. And so this will just kind of be a continuation of that. I doubt we'll ever actually remove those because of linking issues, but we would encourage strongly everybody to switch to the new APIs once they're available. And then lastly, we wanted to talk about Google Summer of Code 2021. So I'm gonna turn it over to Susan for her to speak a little bit about that.
Hello, hello. I guess the big news has gone out on the community forum, which is that we have received our acceptance for this year. So we we are going to be a mentor again this year. Google has made substantial changes to Summer of Code for this year. The big one is that it's only supporting half of the paid hours that it did in the past. So now we're looking at accepting projects along the lines of 4 weeks of full-time work rather than 8 weeks of full-time work. And that time can be spread out and distributed however it works for the student. The application period formally for students is it starts at the 29th, I believe, the very, very end of this month. We are ready to accept applications at that time. Now, if there are any questions, I see that we have Bart and Peter here. I'm certainly interested in answering questions.
And also too, for any prospective students, not just for people here, but for people who may be watching this on YouTube afterwards, since we realize not everyone can come at this time. We would really like to have an open dialogue with people on the community site. In the past, we've often gotten a lot of private messages, but it's an open source community and open source discussion. I know some people are often worried, oh, what if somebody steals my idea for their own proposal? But if we've been talking with you, we know who you are and we don't know who the random proposal copier is, right? So part of this is, you know, how often are we interacting with you and the depth of that interaction? And also, are you making changes on GitHub or proposing, you know, making pull requests and things like that? Having a discussion on issues, you know, the goal here is to really make sure that you're an active and engaged contributor. That's kind of what stands out the most to us in a lot of cases. And we want to kind of encourage that as much as possible.
Yeah, and I guess with the shortened scope of all of these projects, we're just going to want to try to get productive faster if we can. And the more engaged students are to start with, the better that's going to go for everybody.
Exactly. So, and I want to thank Susan. So Susan's been the point person. This is her third year in a row now, I believe, being the point person for Google Summer of Code. And, the fact that Google has made all these additional changes this year, she's done an excellent job weathering all that chaos on our end. So I really appreciate that. And I guess at this point, Peter or Bart, do you have any questions for us? Because we could take those now. And, you know, I know, Peter, you've been helping test with the iOS stuff a little bit. If you have any thoughts on the iOS rollout, kind of interesting hearing those as well.
Maybe not.
Okay. Well, then this is probably the shortest meetup we've had. So that's good.
It looks like Peter's commented here.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah, so Peter is helping manage all that. So we're going to be pretty active, I think, next couple of days on the community site trying to address iOS issues. So if you have been using iOS and you have encountered a problem, please just ping us and let us know. We're happy to make sure we're logging that and tracking it on our internal issue tracker so we can make sure we can address it as part of our next update. All right. So I guess if there aren't any other comments, we'll continue the discussion over in the community site. And for the YouTube watchers, I'll put a link in the description. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.